Welcome to Module 2 in a series of lectures on how to detect glaucomatous damage using OCT scans. And in this module, I'm going to tell you about a one-page report that we've developed to help clinicians quickly diagnose and understand glaucomatous damage. Before I begin, let's do a brief review. Here's a typical current commercial report. When I lecture on this to ophthalmologists and optometrists, I ask people what do they look at in a report such as this. So for example, do they look at the average total thickness here? And most individuals say yes. I ask, do they look at the quadrant thickness? Again, most say yes. How about the clock hours? Well, fewer say yes, but some do. What about the actual thickness plot here? Well, that's the answer is often yes, but not always. What about looking at the scan? Well, most people don't look at the scan, or if they do, I'm not sure what they're seeing. It's so small, I can't use this. And then I ask them about the thickness map. And again, some say yes, but certainly fewer than the ones who say yes to the average thickness or the quadrant. All right, so what about what do I look at? Well, first of all, I seldom look at these measures. I certainly look at the thickness plot, but only after I can trust the segmentation, which I'll say more about in a moment. What about the image? I find it totally useless at this magnification. A large image is absolutely essential. However, you know, as I'll expand upon in a moment. And I certainly look at versions of this, but it's best when combined with other information. So what should a report look like? Well, here's our answer. And I want to emphasize here that this is a one-page report for both helping clinicians quickly diagnose, because I think you can be much faster with this report, and also to understand the nature of damage. Now, this report is based upon three scans: a cube scan of the disc. In the cases I'll be showing you, these scans have 128 individual line scans. A cube scan of the macula, and something that's optional but I find useful, a separate circle scan of the disc. Now I'm going to show you later that you can get by without the circle scan, and I'll show you that it's actually possible to get this information with just a single scan as long as it includes both the macula and the disc. All right, so from these scans, we get this report. So let's take this report in pieces. So from the cube scan of the disc, so that's the region of the, what you're seeing here is the region of the 128 line scans around the disc. There's one of the line scans. That's retinal nerve fiber layer thickness. So we're going to take the retinal nerve fiber thickness from these 128 line scans, and the software develops a thickness map. And this is in retinal view. So here's the thickness map. Dark red is thick. Dark blue is thin. We can derive a circle scan, derive a circle scan from this plot, as I mentioned in the first module. And that's what this solid circle, a solid line is. Now we also, as part of our lab report, get a high definition circle scan because I like the image better. And I'm showing that as the dashed line here, but you don't have to worry about that. All right, second, from the cube scan of the macula, so here it is down here, a cube scan of the macula, which also has 128 line scans. That's what one of them looks like right through the fovea. That's the retinal nerve fiber layer. There's the retinal nerve fiber layer thickness from the macula. And again, dark blue is thin. We could also get retinal ganglion cell plus inner plexiform layer thickness. And here's a thickness map of the retinal ganglion cell plus inner plexiform layer thickness, which I'll call just retinal ganglion cell. And again, dark red is thick and dark blue is thin. All right, so two representations of the retinal nerve fiber layer, one for the macula and one for the disc. We can stitch these together since we know and the software knows the center of the fovea and the center of the disc. All right, now I'll probably mention this more than once. In fact, I know I'll mention this more than once. This is not about a report. It's actually about a method or a process. We could add other things to this one page, right? But the important point is the process that I'm going to tell you about that's involved in trying to understand these scans. And the process or method is based upon five principles. The first principle is that circumpapillary images should be large enough to see details. You want to be able to see segmentation errors, local damage, local blood vessels. So in this particular case, you can see this is a nice large image. You can see the details. That's the way it looks in the original, by the way. I can't make out anything from that, right? So you want to look at a larger image like this. Now, what do I mean by segmentation errors? Well, all algorithms, all commercial machines will make mistakes. So, for example, if the image is poor, a common mistake is that the retinal nerve fiber layer is combined with other layers. So in this particular case, you can see what is being segmented as the retinal nerve fiber layer actually includes much, much more than the retinal nerve fiber layer. Here's an example of some tissue next to a vessel that's being ignored. Here's an epiretinal membrane giving a false reading of the retinal nerve fiber layer, and a vitreal separation also messing up the algorithm and providing a false information. All right, so in addition to examining this image to make sure it's of good quality, right? The second principle is you need to understand the relationship between regions of the circumpapillary thickness plot, that is regions of this, and regions of the retina. So let's blow this up and take a closer look at it. So this is the circumpapillary retina nerve fiber layer thickness plot, dark line. Oh, so as I tell my undergraduates and I tell the audiences that I lecture, give this lecture to, I have a theory about lectures that if they're well designed, there's usually one or two choice points. And by a choice point, I mean it's your choice to pay attention and follow what's going on for the next couple of minutes, or you might as well choose to go to sleep. Now, fortunately, since this is recorded, if you do fall asleep, you can replay it later or tomorrow. All right, so this is key information. What we want to develop here is a map of the retinal nerve fiber layer from retina to temporal disc. And what I show here are some retinal nerve fiber layer bundle tracings from Jansonius et al. Article in 2012. So these were tracings from fundus photos of young healthy eyes. The solid circle here is meant to be the disc, and the dashed circle is the location of the circumpapillary retinal nerve fiber layer thickness plot. So let's just take the bundles coming from noon. This is just an approximate model we're creating. I call it a schematic model. So there's the retinal nerve fiber bundles for noon. The ones coming from 6 o'clock would be something like that. And that's the region encompassed. Now here's a really key point. This part of the retina has a unique relationship with the temporal half of the disc and vice versa. That's unlike other parts of the disc in the sense that all the ganglion cells in this region, on average, send their axons to the temporal half, and all the axons entering the temporal half only come from this region. To understand this, consider, for example, this region, by the way, is encompasses about plus or minus 15 degrees from fixation and what's called, here are the 24-2 locations, by the way, and encompasses what's called the nasal step region as well. So this is the part of your visual field that would be involved with the temporal half of the disc. Now, compare that, for example, to these points up here. Axons from the ganglia cells near this point feed into the nasal half here, something just past noon, but so do axons from way up here and those off the screen. So once you get beyond 12 o'clock on the nasal side or 6 o'clock on the nasal side, you're going to have axons coming not only from your central region, but also from region areas outside the central region. All right, so here's a circumpapillary plot. Remember, I told you that these were called T-SNP plots because they start in the temporal and go around to the temporal. Notice what's happening here. It splits the center field. By plotting this as a T-SNP plot, you've got your superior retina over here and your inferior over here, splitting them in two. And in fact, you even have some superior retina over here, right? So what we're going to do instead in all of our reports is we're going to plot these as instant plots instead. That is, we're going to plot these as if the scan started in the middle of the nasal quadrant and went counterclockwise, started here and went counterclockwise. So now you can see the center part of your visual field, plus or minus 15 degrees plus the nasal step, is now centered in the beginning, in the middle of this plot. We've done a lot of work in asking how the ganglia cells in the macula relate to areas of the temporal disc. And I'm going to remind you, by macula, I'm always going to mean plus or minus 8 degrees from fixation. And this is the part of the retina that has that's relatively small. It's less than 2% of the retina, and it has over 30% of the ganglion cells. So this is our map here of the relationship for the macula. And this is where it appears on the circumpapillary retinal nerve fibrillary thickness map. Notice this is not at zero. That's because on average, the disc on the retina, center of the disc, falls above the center of the fovea. So this point's here about. All right, instant plot instead of a T-SNP plot. Okay, so the circumpapillary retinal nerve fibrillator scan, this here, and the thickness plot, this here, should be shown as an instant, not a T-SNP plot. So if we just blow this up, you can see we even mark the regions so you can make the comparison easier. Notice right away, you can see a defect here, and I can tell you immediately it's going to be in the macula. More about that in a minute. All right, principle number 3. Retinal ganglion cell thickness map is also needed to detect glaucomatous damage. If you only get a disc scan, which is the common protocol in many parts, in many clinics in many parts of the world, if you only get that, you're going to miss glaucomatous damage of the macula. We've shown that. Others have shown that. So we want to look at a retinal ganglion cell thickness of the macula. So remember, as part of this protocol, we have a cube scan of the macula. And so we can get the retinal ganglion cell plus thickness. And again, less than 2% of the retina area, over 30% of the ganglion cells. That's what the normal would look like. That dark circle is has a radius of 8 degrees. And if we blow this up, you'll notice there's a piece missing here, right? That's because the macula is damaged. And we already guessed that from this here, which is related to that. All right, point number 4. You want to examine the retinal nerve fiber layer and retinal ganglion cell probability maps, because damage is often easy to see on a probability map. Now, who said anything about probability maps, you might be saying. All right, so let me tell you about probability maps. So we're going to take this thickness map here, and we're going to compare point by point the thickness in this patient to a control group. And then we're going to color code it. So dark red means significant at the 0.001 level. Green would be not significant, probability of 10% or greater. And then in between would be in between. So red is 1%, yellow is 5%, and then it's graded continuously. You can see this defect here on the probability map that corresponds to that. So just let's test yourself to see if you're following this. What would the retinal ganglion cell probability map look like for an eye with normal thickness? Think about this for a second. So what would this look like if there's no abnormality? Well, it'd be all green. Now, it may have some spotty red stuff due to artifacts, but it's basically will not have a pattern to it. All right. What about retinal nerve fiber layer thickness probability maps? Well, we have two maps here of the retinal nerve fiber layer, one for the macula, one for the disc, and they come from these scans. We can stitch them together, as I mentioned a few minutes ago, because we know the center of the disc and the center of the fovea. And then we turn them into a probability map in the same way by comparing the thickness here, point by point, with norms, and then coding it. Green being not significant, red, dark red being highly significant. And you can see there's a thinning here, right, that's associated with this dip here, and it's producing this region of red here. Oops, sorry. Okay. All right, so you want to examine probability map because it's often easier to see damage on these maps. So the now, what we actually do in our this is our complete report. What we actually do for the report, and here's a new concept, is we take this, we create this probability map, and then we flip it vertically, because remember the image on the back of the eye is flipped, so that this is in field view. So now we have this probability map in field view, which is going to allow us to compare it to visual fields. Same thing, we turn this into a probability map, we rotate it along the horizontal axis here, and we get a field view. So now this is superior field but inferior retina, and this is inferior field and superior retina. Yeah? And again, highly probable, highly significant rather, and within normal limits. This is our lab report. This is our lab report. The only thing that we haven't told you about yet are these points here. We also carry along the quadrant because of all the statistics, this is the one that people use most, and it's probably the best of the metrics. All right. Last point, and this may be the most critical point. Damage can be confirmed by topographically comparing the 10-2 and the 24-2 visual field probability maps, these things here, probability maps, to the OCT probability maps, these here. So let's take a look. Let's blow this up here. So what you're looking at here is the probability map for the retinal ganglion cells, as I've already mentioned, and superimposed on it are the 10-2 visual field points. So these are just the point locations. There's nothing about the significance of those points, just the point locations. Right? Now you may notice that they're morphed, that is, they started out on the actual visual field having equal distances between them, but here you can see they're morphed. That's because we have to take into consideration the fact that the ganglion cells near the fovea have been pushed away during development so that there's nothing blocking the light. Well, at least the ganglion cells are not blocking light on the way to the receptors or scattering the light. Another way of putting this is light striking here where the red arrow is actually stimulating ganglion cells out here someplace. Okay. And we actually know from a paper done by Drasdow, Curcio, and colleagues what this relationship is. So we're able to use their data to morph these points. Okay. So here's the probability map now. Here is the patient's 10-2 total deviation probability map. We can circle these points and ask if they're in the same place. They are, and here they are too, right? And here it is up here. So you can see the agreement between the 10-2 abnormal region and the OCT. Or we can go in reverse. We can circle this point, this here, and see where it falls. Here's a 24-2 for this patient. Whoa, looks pretty clean, doesn't it? Right? This is so-called pre-parametric damage. Why don't you see the abnormality here? We know it's there. Well, I'll show you why. Here's the abnormality. Right? Notice it's falling between the 24-2 points. If we would take this and put it over here, it falls right there between those points. Right? Glaucoma hemifield test within normal limits, and patent standard deviation with normal limits. By any set of criteria, this would be considered absolutely normal, but if you only had this 24-2, you'd be missing this defect very close to fixation. All right, so that's the report. What about validation? Well, we've done a couple of studies. So in the first study, first of all, this is the report, right? In the first study that we published in 2014 with our colleagues in glaucoma in New York City, the student, Ali Raza, who was my colleague and partner in all of this work, and I judged whether an eye was glaucomatous strictly based on the report, and it turned out that we had better agreement and equal or better diagnostic accuracy than the glaucoma specialists did. And in their case, they had 24-2s, they had disc photos, they had the standard OCT reports. In fact, what was interesting about this is we did nearly as well without the visual fields. The criticism of this paper was that, oh, well, you know, this was just two of us and we've been working for a long time. It ignored the fact that neither of us were MDs, but that's okay. So we then trained two fellows and two pre-med students to use this report. And the pre-med students were just recently graduated undergraduates. And these four also showed better agreement than the glaucoma specialists in the first study. And the glaucoma specialist had fundus photos, visual fields, and OCT commercial reports. Their diagnostic accuracy was also equal or greater. All right, so that's module two. After you take a break, or maybe tomorrow, or next week, or when you get a chance, I hope you'll turn to module three. Thank you very much for listening.